Hello and welcome to the next in our series of webinars and all sorts of things that we do at UKAEA. Hopefully you caught last week and a couple of our graduate engineers talking about our graduate scheme and graduate schemes in general. And hopefully you'll enjoy this talk on RACE, which is our robotics facility. So, to start, little bit about who I am. Following on from last week's, I'm a graduate mechatronics engineer in the cybernetics group of RACE, which means that this talk will be given a slight bit of a cybernetics slant to it. I'm much more likely to talk about systems of systems and the software and the programming and the development and the interconnection of systems rather than purely mechanical or purely electrical systems. And similarly, in the answers that I'll give to the questions later at the end, they'll probably give them that slight slant as well. This talk is here to answer a few questions. I think RACE is a really exciting place to work. It's a really exciting sort of hub of robotics expertise, really, and that needs to be put out there. So talk a little about what RACE is, where we started from in general. Talk a bit about what we're trying to do as an organization within the UK, and also touch on some of the really cool and interesting projects that we're working on, both inside inside Fusion and outside, sort of more widely in industry. So to start off, let's have a look at where we're based. This is an aerial shot of the Calm Science Center, basis of the Calm Center for Fusion Energy. And there are a few buildings I'd like to highlight here. On the right, you can see JET and its two huge assembly hall door sort of batteries at the top. And on the left, you can see Master U. If you look just sort of a bit further past Master U, you will see a large white building with a smaller gray building attached to it. And that is RACE. RACE is a reasonably new addition to UKAEA as a whole, and is, as I said a little bit before, it's our hub for robotics research. So it's span out of our remote handling facility. It's not, I should say, the only department like this within UKAEA. We have a whole bunch. And I should say this, I should have opened with this. RACE stands for Remote Applications in Challenging Environments. There will be a lot of acronyms within this talk. I'll do my very best to catch them and explain them as I say them. If I do miss one, then feel free to call me out in the chat. And I'll try and keep an eye on that and say that, or just ask me again the questions at the end. As I said, there's a whole bunch of other departments as well that are all working towards this sort of universal goal of developing fusion energy and sort of putting fusion energy on the grid. Within RACE, we work on a number of projects. Obviously, quite a lot of this talk is going to be about JET, the Joint European Torus. It's the largest currently active fusion experiment, and it's based here in sunny Oxfordshire. But we also work on other other projects as well. So big names they'll be coming to later on in the talk are ITER, which may or may not stand for International Tokamak Experimental Reactor, or just ITER. DEMO, which is a demonstration fusion power plant, which is a project to put fusion energy on the grid. We work outside of fusion in projects like the European Spallation Source, ESS. And we work on a variety of other autonomous systems, remote vehicle testing, VR, and all sorts of other areas. The vision of RACE as a whole is to try and ensure that hazardous environments in general aren't a barrier to human endeavor. And obviously, we've come at this from a slightly fusion bent. So some of the hazardous environments that we're considering are radiological hazards. So how do you deal with robotics and very delicate machinery and electronics when you're having to cope with potentially very high levels of radiation? And this is not the only area we're interested in. There are other hazardous environments that we can develop in. Think of spaces of routine hazardous environment, or we'd be interested in doing things like deep sea or other areas where you don't necessarily want to put people. And all of these different areas where robotics can be applied are interconnected. You can have reasonably large amounts of cross-transferability between these areas. Overall, however, our mission is the realization of commercial fusion power, working with other groups and other companies within the UK to really push technical leadership in robotics. So making sure that we, as the UK Atomic Energy Authority, just in general, as the UK as an industry hub, have this world-leading expertise in remote handling and maintain this world-leading expertise in remote handling, which we've developed over the operation lifetime of JET. And there's a few lists of various activities here, but I'm actually going to come back to those in a bit. Because I want to talk first about where we came from. So it is our largest sort of major piece of work that spun us out as a group was JET remote handling. So I'm going to take you way back to 1983, which is when this photo was taken, as JET is being constructed. And JET is being sort of managed and maintained. And you can see that all of this is being done by a person sitting inside wearing a hard hat and a white suit and white shoes. And this is basically true for the next quite a few years. So as the machine develops, you can see occasionally the amount of PPE that these people are wearing steps up a bit. So it went from just a hard hat to now a full head covering, no more exposed beards. Full suits rather than just sort of a white suit and shoes. And again, people inside the vessel doing the testing, making sure that they're trying to minimize contamination, but it's just people inside. This is now 1989. Moving forward to 1991, now that people are starting to wear sort of positive pressure ventilation systems, so they're trying to minimize the amount of air contamination people are exposed to, if any. Though that doesn't sort of maintain itself forever. In 1993, one thing I quite like about this photo is you can see there's even signage up inside the vessel, emergency lights and big green exit signs when they're doing operations. Again, people doing all the work, people replacing tiles, people putting things and mapping them down and writing down exactly what they've done. And this is true continuously, again, 1994, 1996. And then after 1996, something changes. So this is JET before 1996, and this is JET in 1998. So these photos are taken during the end of sort of major shutdowns that we've done, of Germany for maintenance and significant upgrades and repair. And what you'll notice in this image and in all images from this point is that where there used to be a person in a suit, there is now this thing up in the corner, which you can't really see particularly well in this image. But what that is a device called Mascot. Because in 1997, we ran JET's first tritium campaign. And after running a tritium campaign, we didn't really want to send people inside the vessel anymore. It was too dangerous. We were too concerned about the sort of radiation levels within the vessel. A deuterium-tritium reaction compared to our standard pulses generates a lot more neutrons and makes the inside of the vessel much more hazardous to enter in comparison. So we have this device. And this device has to do everything that those people were doing before. So it has to be really dexterous. It has to be able to cope with all sorts of welding jobs and bolting jobs and cutting and placement and full repairs. Every bit of maintenance inside the vessel has to be done with this. And you can see that this is, you can't actually see how it's mounted currently, but it's a twin-armed manipulator with a series of cameras attached to it. It's mounted on the end of this long flexible boom that actually goes behind the vessel here. There's an entry port on the other side. And we're looking through sort of the parallel entry port here. And you can see in all these images, it's in the process of repairing or maintaining some part of the vessel, be that these nice, easy to access inner wall panels, or even these small panels up the top that it has to replace and repair. In 2011, when we did the major upgrade to JET, providing the ITER-like wall enhancement, so this is moving JET towards ITER, so developing technologies to allow ITER the chance to succeed, ITER being the next major fusion experiment being done, a big international collaboration. And in this shutdown, 90% of the work, 90% of the tile replacements were done, more than 90% of the tile replacements were done using this device. And we're moving towards a vision of 100% remote intervention rather than any sort of manual intervention being done. And this is an image from 2017 at the end of our last major shutdown, where you can see that all of these big enhancements from 1998 to now have really been done predominantly using this device. Big sort of full diverter replacements, inner wall replacements, all sorts of things. As you can imagine, developing technology, going from our state-of-the-art back in sort of the 80s to state-of-the-art nowadays, we have built up huge amounts of operational experience working with this. I think, yeah, it says there, so 30,000 hours of operational experience just doing maintenance repair of JET. And this is means we've had to develop techniques and tooling for managing this, which is basically unlike anywhere else in the world at the moment. So every part that goes inside the vessel, everything that has to be replaced, every component that we have to mount or take off, and all the tools associated with doing that have to be made to be remote handling compatible. And here's a few images that are examples of just what those adjustments are. So you can see here, I'll do a little video in a second to see how this all works. We can see this is a tile carrier, I think, with gripping points and this sort of big yellow clip here, which has an interesting purpose, and other sections of tools, other groups of tools, which again are fitted out to be remote handling compatible. And these are all fairly bespoke tools I'm showing here, but this applies to other tools that you might not necessarily think as needing much adaption to be remote handling compatible. A pair of pliers, for instance, which can be very, very useful for performing maintenance and repair, but how do you do it when what you have is a two-fingered gripper to work with? So managing these adaptions, managing these and planning these projects. So every movement that goes inside the vessel has to be carefully planned out. There's a little video showing Mascot moving inside the vessel, and indeed Mascot at work alongside its sort of counterpart tile carrier. So tools and tiles are brought in on one end, Mascot is brought in through the other, and they sort of work in tandem to do these maintenance and repair jobs. Just let that play out briefly. It's not necessarily immediately clear from this image, but the types of maintenance that you have to do with this device, it's more challenging than just going in and actually controlling this device is a job into itself. Not to mention the fact that some of the tiles and components that are moving are incredibly heavy or have to be mounted at very odd angles. You saw in one of the earlier images, there was a Mascot mounting a component high up on the outer wall at a really odd angle. But this is all being done by a person sitting in a chair or possibly standing up, holding what we call a master manipulator and doing this one-to-one movement mapping of all our motions from inside. They're staring at a bank of monitors because, again, we don't have binocular vision inside here. So to get some sort of idea of depth, you've got to look at one angle from dead on and one angle from the side and then try to figure out how exactly your depth is working. We have accompanying sort of VR systems as well to look at where this device is inside the vessel and plan out our routes. And like I mentioned, this is all set up with very sophisticated force feedback mechanisms. So this operator can feel the bolt runner matching the bolt. One of the tests that we do to see whether somebody is sort of capable of running Mascot inside the actual vessel is having them play Jenga with the device, which seems silly at first, but when you realize that's actually quite a nimble, dexterous task, and doing it from 100 meters away through a completely remote connection like this is a real indicator of the sort of skill that these operators have developed over the years. And we need our operators to be very skilled indeed, because the value of the tools and the tiles that we're working with are huge. So some of these inner wall tiles and outer wall tiles are basically pure beryllium, and dropping them would be a very bad thing indeed. So all quite pricey. So how do we work with this? Where do we take our technology from here? So we've obviously built up this huge bank of expertise, but you'd think that'd be very specific to JET, right? So we are the only place in the world that has this bank of knowledge, because are we the only place in the world that needs to have it, right? Working to talk about it. And the answer is no. We're looking at pushing this technology, developing this expertise, and using it for future fusion devices as well. So now I'd like to sort of pivot slightly towards ITER and looking ahead. So JET, here's a sort of a scale model of JET. You can see just down here, there's a little person in a white suit and a hard hat there. And these big orange transformer limbs on the outside, and there's the inside of the vessel. So ITER is an international project currently being built in the south of France. And I say international, it really is truly international. And the idea is this is to break the Q factor limit of basically try to generate more power than we put into generating the fusion reaction. So we don't actually be generating electricity from this, we'll just be measuring it. But with something like JET, we can get out about 0.6, 0.7 times the fusion power out the electricity in. With something like ITER, we're looking to get about 10 times the power out than it. And it's got a whole bunch of other systems as well. So it's testing tritium breeding, for instance. So running these deuterium tritium campaigns can be very expensive. Getting a hold of these things to work with, getting a hold of the tritium to work with just in its raw form is difficult unless you can breed it yourself. So we're testing these technologies that are going to be necessary to take fusion to the next level, put fusion on the grid. And again, even then, so this, how does this relate to JET, you might say? Well, obviously it's very similar, right? It's a large tokamak. And this, unlike JET, where we built it by hand and then maintained it with robotics, will be being built with robotics, will be designed to be maintainable from the get-go with very accurate CAD models for every single component on the inside and plans to maintain all of those parts. So developing robotic systems, using our knowledge of how to replace tiles, how to mount components, and transferring that over towards JET is a really big asset that the UK community has in this international project. And we're really using that for future projects. Then there's also demo. So I mentioned this very briefly at the start. This is even larger than ITER, and it's currently in a pre-concept phase. And the idea here is to not only generate fusion power more than you put in, but also then take that fusion power and put it onto the grid and get something that is making electricity that can actually be used and demonstrate fusion as an energy generation prospect. I'm actually going to show a couple of images to do with some of the challenges we're facing around developing a fusion device this large. Because you can see the size of JET, I think it's completely tiny in relation to the size of demo. The entirety of JET would almost fit inside one of the single, inside the void, inside the torus. Not quite, but it's huge. There's a person there for reference as well. Person there for reference, and there's a little tiny dude back there. So let's, and also one other big fusion device that we're looking at leveraging our knowledge of JET towards is STEP, which you, I'd be a bit remiss to go without saying. I mentioned MAS very briefly earlier. STEP is kind of taking the spherical tokamak design the next stage further, and we're looking at taking our knowledge of both from both MAST and JET and using this to create our own UK-based tokamak for energy generation using the more spherical design. I don't have tons of time to go really into the details of how STEP works and how STEP's different from demo and how MAST U is different from JET, but I really would recommend going and having a look at that and seeing really how the UK has paved the way in terms of spherical tokamak design, as well as just our general fusion expertise. So I mentioned before that we had some challenges. So we've got JET. It's a machine that we really understand fundamentally, and it has challenges that we have decades facing and experience overcoming. But future maintenance for these future fusion devices like ITER, like DEMO, they have their own problems to face, not least due to the sheer scale that we'll be working with. Inside JET, we're pretty fortunate that the sort of levels of neutron bombardment are reasonably low. So the activation of the components from the inside of the vessel is reasonably limited, and we can handle that on site pretty adeptly. Larger devices obviously will have a larger neutron yield, and therefore will need to have more sophisticated ways of dealing with sort of the low-level waste that you'll get with that, the activated components from the inside of the vessel. Because while fusion, obviously, its output when you fuse hydrogen is helium, which is nice and easy to deal with. In our case, deuterium and tritium, it's still helium and neutron. The actual parts themselves, the tiles on the inside of the wall, the magnets and things, they become irradiated over time. So how do we take those components? How do we manage them down? And how do we store them, take them out of the vessel? How do we chop them into smaller pieces? How do we then replace them all with this reasonably radioactively hot environment? So we're looking at developing VR systems for imaging areas that we can't necessarily put people in, where we might have limited camera access because large amounts of neutron bombardment does bad things to cameras. So from an outside perspective, outside the tokamak, there's already some sort of big challenges to start overcoming, taking components out of the vessel. But even inside the tokamak, we've got here in this image, you can see this is a little cross-section of a demo-like reactor. This is probably not completely up to date. But you can hear we've got service pipes and access pipes, and there's also going to be more coming in from all sorts of other angles. And we are going to need to be able to sever some of these components without putting a person in with a welding torch. So this little device down at the bottom left here is a pipe runner, which will run up the inside of the pipe and weld it, cut and weld it, all from within the inside of the pipe. You can see these are here are successful cuts that this has performed. And it does this using a really neat high-powered laser, which is fitted on the inside. And that's one bit of the remote handling we're doing. But as well, we've got to take these components out. So a demo-like device has large, you know, in its current design, large blanket segments. These basically are modules that are like our tiled wall. So rather than replacing individual tiles, we'll just take entire sections out at once. And this here is a bit of a demonstration of how one might do that. It doesn't really show the details, but you've got a vertical extraction here, and it's going to be taken up and tilted into a nice transporter cask, which will be taken elsewhere when we're replacing them. And similarly, the transporter parts come in, tilted down, dropped in. And that sounds nice and simple, until you realize that these components here are huge. They're three stories tall. They weigh maybe upwards of 70 tons. And if these are being used to do tritium breeding, these could contain various liquid components for that within them. What this means is that what we're dealing with is a very large spring, it may be loaded with a liquid, that we have to take out and put in through a lift and twist motion through really actually restricted access ports, given the size of the components that we're dealing with. So finding ways in developing technologies to track this, especially in the extraction phase, where we can't put cameras on this, because cameras might get destroyed by the radiation necessarily. We can't really use many other sensing tools. We might not have any sensing on the component itself as it goes in. How do we stop the whole, this big spring that we're moving around from shaking and oscillating? How do we make sure that we're getting it carefully into place without damaging any of the other components within the vessel? And these are problems that we're starting to think of now. Even if demo itself is sort of still 30 years in the future, we're looking at sort of an online of, I think, 2050 for demo. We've got to start thinking about these conundrums now and start developing technologies. Like the one down at the bottom left, this is an actual thing that we've started developing and prototyping now to help face these. I've talked a little bit about a few things, so tooling design, process development, how we develop systems, what facilities and structures that we have and how we're working with. But this is only like a small section of what RACE is as a whole. We have all sorts of other areas that we're working in. So big ones that I've sort of touched on, positional control, so how we might deal with these oscillations and vibrations, how we might look at components and inspect for faults when we can't send people in. So using pipe runners, using other remote inspection devices to check on the integrity of components. Doing remote viewing, taking advantage of our digital twin technology. So you saw in the previous slide, there was an image of our, well, we'll quickly go back. There was an image of one of our really sort of flagship pieces, TARM, which was on the sort of the cover image for this presentation, which is this large flexible manipulator that we have in the RACE work hall, and using virtual models to really augment our ability to manipulate components within the vessel and outside the vessel as well. As well as all sorts of other systems, taking advantage of really this huge area, this huge range of techniques that we're experienced in. So looking at this, how are we going to pivot this this whole range of technologies and systems that we're working with towards something that is viable outside of fusion? And the answer is, well, we already have in a lot of cases. So we are at site, we are a major test facility. So we run and have facilities to run UAV tests and UGV tests to see how capable they are in terms of some sort of standardized facility. So how dexterous, how nimble is your ground roving vehicle? How well can you observe different areas using UAVs? And here, so you can see there's a difficult terrain test. So seeing how well this vehicle can get over really challenging terrain, as well as a UAV test. At the back there are actually some very large fans that's dealing with high winds and trying to look inside very narrow access points. And we can score them based on these sort of facilities. So that's one thing we're working on. Another component that I mentioned earlier is the European Spallation Source, ESS. This is actually being built currently in London, Sweden. And it is a, it's basically currently going to be the world's largest neutron source. So how we test components that are under severe neutron bombardment, how do we replicate this? We subject them to severe neutron bombardment and other interesting samples. And it's a big sort of scientific research site. And what we're being involved with in terms of ESS is taking these neutron bombarded components, like the target wheel, so where you mount your sample, and once they have been subject to their full life cycle of bombardment, taking them out and handling them in a safe way. So yeah, this is actually an image here from just on the left here from I think last week. So it's really currently well underway in terms of construction. So what we're looking at here is a hot cell. So taking waste components and then sending out packaged, carefully contained, low-level waste in a safe and controlled way, all without ever sending a person inside the hot cell. Which means that we have to be able to deal with a whole bunch of different factors. And importantly, we can't send a person in to, say, a bandsaw station or a wire saw station or a lifting frame. We can't send people in to maintain them. We have to have them be accessible via other remote means so that we can remotely send a crane in to get it out, send a large cooker arm to change bolts, do all this, and then move it into a facility where it can potentially be, if it needs to be, maintained physically. We're also looking at areas like decommissioning. So here are some images from two nuclear decommissioning bids for, I think, Sellafield. So the one on the right is Nudicom, which is with Nuvia, and left it's E2A. I'm going to talk a little bit more about E2A. So that's using a combination of the race technologies and expertise in remote handling, VR, and some really sophisticated radiation imaging tools to have a new approach to how we might manage doing nuclear decommissioning. And what I'm going to close on a little bit is some of our really sophisticated work that we're doing in terms of AI and autonomous systems. So there's a couple of videos here that I can show. That one might not work, actually. Looking at, so here we've got two particular ones which are looking at how we might use computer vision to avoid collision if you're trying to manipulate components inside a works inside a glove box work cell. So you've got robotic arms that are going to be moving things around, shifting components from one place to another, chopping them up and whatnot. And automatically, we want to make sure that we don't collide them together or run them into the walls or take a component and hit that against something else, because it might damage things. We've got condition monitoring, so planning in advance, monitoring how a system is reacting as it undergoes all the stresses of daily life inside a radioactive environment, so that we can plan our maintenance before it actually fails, minimize the amount of unplanned downtime. Optimal grasping, which is looking at components and figuring out how to best hold them, which seems like a pretty trivial thing until, again, remember that we're working largely with two-fingered manipulators. So you don't have a helpful hand. Your brain is really good at figuring out how to hold things. You know not to grab, intuitively, not to grab a long flexible thing by the thinnest point, right? You're going to hold it differently. You're not going to hold a knife by the blade. You're going to hold a knife by the handle. And similarly, we need to be able to teach the robotics to using various AI techniques to optimally grasp different components so that we can minimize the amount of failures and drops. And all sorts of other really interesting computer vision techniques. So just a few listed down at the bottom right. And we're doing part of this, doing this as part of the RAIN consortium, which is sort of a big UK-based industry and university collaboration. Okay. I have been through quite a lot there. It's just a little after 2:05. Or just coming up 2:05, a little after 2:00. At this point, I think I'm going to be, hope you've enjoyed the talk so far. I'm going to be around for a little bit to answer some questions that you've got, and I can see a few coming in already. Please do put them in the chat. Don't just raise your hand because I don't think we have facility to bring you on air at the moment, but if you put the questions in the chat, then we'll do our best to answer them. I'd just like to highlight quickly any questions that I don't have great answers for, I'm going to probably direct you to email communications@uka.uk. And also keep an eye on next week's topic as well, which is How to Drive a Docker Mac by David Keeling, which is a really interesting talk. But for now, let's go to the questions. So thank you, everyone. Ella.
Thank you, John. That was awesome. So we've got the first question here. It says, hi, I've not been to CCFE since summer 2017. How have your robotics moved on since then?
Okay, so at CCFE in general, we've had, I think in race particularly, we've had pretty major strides in what our robotics capability was like since then. So summer 2017 was about the first time that I got really involved with race as an organization. And we were just starting to think about bringing in manipulators like Tom, increasing our, I think we had like maybe a QCA or two, and we had a one UGV. We had reasonably limited robotic capability, which is really just multiplied. We have a whole range of different industry manipulators are currently accessible. We have TARM, the telescopic articulated robotic manipulator, or possibly remote mast, that is a test bed for testing systems like upgrades to our mascot manipulator. Really, our robotic capability has never been higher than it is right now. In terms of what we use inside the vessel, that hasn't changed significantly. But we are still on an ongoing road to upgrade, so there are going to be future shutdowns where we look at taking some of the legacy components that are currently doing the maintenance of the inside of the vessel and bringing them really up to spec with what we have technology-wise nowadays.
Great. So the next one we've got is, what software engine do you use for the digital twin?
Okay. For the current stuff that's being used on Jet, I think we're using, what's it called? It'll come back to me in a second. Just the name just escaped my mind. We're looking at using a variety of different technologies. The ones we're currently developing as alternative digital twins that are not inside the vessel, we're looking at using engines like Unreal. Yes, that is the same sort of thing as you use to play computer games with. Turns out they're really, really good for rendering complex 3D models, which is exactly what you'd expect. So using these technologies and leveraging them for our own purposes. The one inside the vessel is called VR for Robots, which is a bit of a legacy system that we have just a lot of experience using. And it's really synchronized into our knowledge of the waypointing and the systems that are being used for vessel maintenance and repair. But I think VR for robots is not necessarily sort of where we're looking at going forwards. I don't know for certain. It's a whole range of things.
Okay, so then the next one is, what are the biggest challenges for condition monitoring? Do you have enough sensors now, or is there always a demand for more?
Well, coming from a cybernetics point of view, the more sensors we have, the better. Coming from a realistic point of view, there will be severe limitations on what we can put on. In fact, running complex strain gauges and IMUs to every single joint at every single point you might want to measure is not necessarily computationally difficult, but it's actually very difficult to fit all these diagnostics back down the booms and things that we're working with. I'd say the biggest challenges for condition monitoring is actually developing the models to detect and plan maintenance before failure occurs. I think we currently have PhDs out researching this topic. It's not just sensing, it's using these sensors. It's managing this huge data flow that we have back from our diagnostics and taking useful, tangible data out of that.
Okay. What sort of AI methods are used for teaching robotic devices?
Well, it depends what it's for. I know that we have a number of systems using things like deep reinforcement learning. And you can have, without going into the sort of details of how these different systems work, how you teach your robotic device what a good movement and a bad movement is has a pretty big impact on how well it performs and how well it generalizes to different systems. So something like deep reinforcement learning will feed back good examples, but then there's also looking at other AI techniques which can take deliberately misleading examples where you try and say, this looks like a good grip, but you need to learn that it's not actually a good grip, for instance, and will develop what's called adversarial learning, where you're trying to essentially, by developing more challenging puzzles for your AI, improve its ability to handle and generalize more.
We've got the next comment saying, interesting, what type of controllers do you use? Which programming language?
Okay, we have all sorts of, so when you say controllers, I'm just going to answer this sort of more generally. I'm not sure whether you mean sort of PLCs, so low-level control systems. So we use a variety of sort of industry standard programming logic controllers for our various devices. Something like ESS, we're actually working with a whole bunch of different partners externally as well, and they might be using their own systems. So being able to work with a Beckhoff PLC and some other organization PLC and bring the two together is a really big thing that we're working on. We're sort of developing UK essentially middleware, where we're sitting between these layers of abstractions to these devices so we can maintain them. As far as controllers in terms of physical manipulation goes, all sorts of things again. So you'll see some videos, if you look at the Race YouTube channel, of people using haptic pens to control devices, people using sort of game controllers to manage things, because these things have been developed to drive reasonably complex systems, computer games, and have a lot of abstraction back to the real world. And again, there's like very specific, sophisticated techniques, things like the mascot master manipulator, which is just very bespoke for working with mascot inside the vessel. And programming languages, a whole bunch. If we're looking at sort of inside low-level PLCs, things like structured text, things like ladder logic, larger systems, we might use C++ quite readily. Some of our older systems run on sort of more legacy languages. Some of our computer vision systems, we use Python. We have people who are really interested in deploying much more modern systems, like modern languages that might have been slightly less tested, like Julia. But I think probably the biggest stuff in terms of race up next, I think at the moment, are C++ and Python for the most part, and structured text for the PLC control.
We had a message on the chat saying, this is the first UKAEA seminar that I have had an invite for. Is there an invite list for future seminars? Finding this really interesting.
I'm going to pass that back to you, Ella, because...
so they're all on our social media platforms, Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, and Twitter. And the link to the Zoom chat changes each week. So you'll need to keep yourself following us on those platforms to see the links each week. And we had another one on the chat saying, what was the name of the game that you used for seeing if people are up for working robotics?
Oh, so that was Jenga. So that's pretty particular to our mascot system. So using the mascot master to drive the mascot manipulator to play a game of Jenga. So it's a tile, a block stacking game, basically. You get a tower of wooden blocks, and you need to be able to push individual blocks out, grip from the other side, and pull them without disturbing the entire tower as a whole. You can imagine how that starts to become very difficult when you only have, you're essentially doing Jenga with one eye shut at a very long way away with two fingers. It starts to become very challenging indeed.
So we've got one here. Thank you very much for the talk. Do you have any fusion related projects which utilize LIDAR? LIDAR.
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 Light distance and ranging. Yes. We have. So I've personally worked on a few projects for ITA that use LIDAR. We use it for sort of large scale volumetric measurements. So trying to determine what the size, where a handling cell might be inside a room, you might use LIDAR for. as well as sort of directional LiDAR systems where you might have a sort of flash LiDAR in rather than just regular photography to sample intricate systems up close. I think for the most part, we use things like a LiDAR for volumetric sampling for hot cell purposes, but I guess you could use it inside the vessel as well. I don't know how radiation hard LiDAR systems are currently. I know that the people are thinking of looking at developing rad hard LiDAR, but I don't think the technology is like super developed at the moment.
Great, we've got one. What skills would you recommend to learn as an electronics graduate that would be useful to work at the race facility?
Okay. Well, I will say, as an electronics graduate, is you are essentially gold dust. So I think the really key thing that we have at UKAEA is we're interested in people with a passion for fusion energy. Most of the skills and things that you'll develop in terms of what you need to be as an electronics engineer are things that you'll learn here or things that you'll get through your degree for the most part. Knowing how to use things like various CAD tools would be very, very useful, and just understanding your degree in general. I'm not an electronics graduate, so I can't give you the most up-to-date answers. I would recommend that you email early careers at UKAEA, as they will really be able to give you much more detailed answers that we're looking for. But I think for the most part, passion, which is not really a skill, but is definitely something you can work on. Finding some things that really interested you in this field.
Great. We've got, thanks for a great talk. Do you use any programming software for your various operations? If so, which ones?
If this is in terms of sort of IDEs, we're pretty flexible to use IDEs as we like. For working in C++, I mostly use either Qt Creator or Visual Studio or VS Code. For doing Python work, I tend to use Jupyter Notebook. But again, this is basically down to personal preference. There are people who will preferentially use Vim or Atom things as well. Depends what area you're working in within the organization.
Another software question. With Magnox remote operations, we are using iGrip, I think that's how you say it, for a robotic simulation. What software package are you currently using? Anything new? Nice webinar, by the way. Thank you.
Okay. A lot of our simulation work and modeling work, we use bespoke stuff, so various plugins for Unreal. We use Universal Robotics manipulators and some of their associated software and ROS to do quite a lot of our other manipulation. And we're developing robotic middleware within UKAEA, within RACE, more generally. I don't know exactly how much detail I can go into on that. But we're constantly on the lookout for what the best sort of industry leading software packages are, and we'll use them as appropriate depending on the bid. We don't really have one designated specific software package that we tend to use, I think.
Okay, we've got one more question here on the QA. Self-healing of materials discussed in space application for some material. Is there any possibility of developing self-healing material for some components in fusion reactors to reduce maintenance and repair?
I'll be entirely honest, this is not my area of expertise. As a relative layperson, as far as this is concerned, I would say that the things that we're concerned about are, in terms of self-healing materials, is a lot of these components aren't designed to work under very high radiation environments. And developing a material that's not only self-healing normally, but also self-healing when subject to sort of 300 gray neutron bombardment and irradiation levels, 300 gray radiation levels and neutron bombardment is even more challenging than just developing self-healing materials in the first place. That's a really interesting question, though, and I would invite you to email it to communications@UKAEA, and sort of really good questions like that, if we can get solid answers to them, they might be able to come up with much more sophisticated answers than I can.
Great, that's all our questions on the Q&A. If anyone thinks of any more, please email us on the email address on the screen. And thank you, John.
No problem. I hope you all enjoyed it. Thank you all.